Welcome to all the students. Today we will be discussing about vaginal discharge. And as it is the clinical type of lecture, so we will be focusing more on the history taking. So first, I would like to share some pathology and physiology about vaginal discharge. Then we will come to the history taking. So in today's class, we will be discussing about differential diagnosis of different kind of vaginal discharge in history taking, and then how to diagnose, and then we will be discussing some case scenarios. So vaginal discharge is basically the most common presenting complaint in young females visiting outpatient clinic. And especially STI, sexually transmitted infectious disease clinic. This is the most common complaint of reproductive age group females. So basically, what is vaginal discharge? It is the secretions which is produced by the glands which are present in the vaginal walls and cervix. But vaginal discharge basically comes from the cervical glands. Although the vaginal glands play a part, but in most of the quantity, it comes from the cervical glands. So this is a anatomical picture of the reproductive organ. As you can see, the uterus and vagina is connected through the cervix, and cervix is the site where the most of the secretions are produced. And apart from the cervix, vagina plays a role. So when we will be discussing about the testing or the procedure, the lab test for the vaginal discharge, then we will be discussing these points. From where the high vaginal swab is taken, from where the intracervical swab is taken. Can you guys see my mouse cursor? Okay, good. So here you can see this is the cervix, this is cervical canal. So if the sample of vaginal discharge for the lab test has to be taken from the intracervical area, so we insert the swab stick over here to take the intracervical swab. If the swab has to be taken from the high vaginal swab, which is the most common one, and we do it routinely in our OPDs, so this is the area from where we take the high vaginal swab. It is basically the area which meets with the cervix. So this is the high vaginal area, and you can see laterally, these are the fornices. These are lateral fornices. So either we can take the high vaginal swab from the high vaginal area or from the fornices. And if the intracervical swab is required, which is required in a specific kind of infection, so we insert the swab stick inside the cervix to take the sample. And if it is the vulvo-vaginal swab, which is basically taken from the lower or mid area of the vagina. So we will be discussing about the lab test later on. First, we will discuss about the theory part. So whenever a female comes to you with complaint of vaginal discharge, it should be categorized whether it is infective or the non-infective. You will be deciding these things on the basis of history. So first, we are going to discuss the types of discharges. If it is non-infective, then there are other causes of those non-infectious discharge we will be discussing the latest slide. But if it is infective, then the there can be two causes. Either it is sexually transmitted infection, or it is self-acquired infection, or it is non-sexually transmitted infections. Usually non-sexually transmitted infections are common in patients with low immunity or immunocompromised status. Okay. If it is non-infectious, so the reason for non-infectious vaginal discharge are multiple. The most common one is physiological. Most of the females, when they are in their age, in their teenage, and they have recently started having menarche, so they are unaware of the physiological discharge. So sometimes the complaint of vaginal discharge is not infectious, not any kind of pathology is beside there. This is only physiological. So on the basis of the history, we have to differentiate better whether it is physiological discharge or there is some problem. So physiological discharge has typical characteristics. They shows variation with the menstrual cycle, like this is maximum in the mid cycle. It can be associated with sexual arousal or the pregnancy also affects vaginal secretions. So they are usually increased during pregnancy. So these are the characteristics of physiological discharge. Other than that, physiological discharge will not be having any kind of a smell. They will not be associated with itching. Their color will be transparent, and it will not be very thick kind of discharge. So these are characteristics of physiological discharge. So if the patient complains she's having vaginal discharge, you have to ask these questions in your history to see whether it is physiological or it is associated with some kind of problem. Okay, if the discharge is not infective, so you have ruled out physiological causes. Now the other causes of the non-infectious discharge, the patient may be having cervical polyp, and this is the outgrowth on over the lips of cervix. So it will result in the due to irritation in the epithelium of the cervix, it may result in the increased cervical discharge or the vaginal discharge. Presence of foreign bodies inside the vagina, like retained tampons or the contraception. This is not conception, this contraceptive device, or vulval dermatitis. The skin problem can lead to irritation of the vagina and increased vaginal discharge. Chemical irritation, use of soaps or deodorants or any kind of chemical material can lead to the irritation of vagina. Use of IUCD leads to increased vaginal discharge, which can be infective and non-infective. And oral contraceptive uses, we all know the contraceptive drugs contain estrogen and progesterone. So if we are giving exogenous estrogen and progesterone in form of oral contraceptive pills, it can lead to increased vaginal discharge, but that is absolutely non-infective. Now comes to the infectious vaginal discharge. Among infectious vaginal discharge, sexually transmitted infections are most common. But among non-sexually transmitted category, we have bacterial vaginosis. So first, we are going to discuss the sexually transmitted infection in which chlamydia and gonorrhea are the most common ones. Other than chlamydia and gonorrhea, we have herpes simplex, trichomoniasis, or and vulvovaginal candidiasis. Okay, vulvovaginal candidiasis is not sexually transmitted. It's written wrong here. It's a non-sexually transmitted infection, vulvovaginal candidiasis. Up to trichomoniasis, they all are infective kind of discharge, sexually transmitted infections. And they all have different characteristics. On the basis of history, you can make the differential diagnosis which type of organism is involved in the specific kind of discharge. Okay, the characteristic of physiological vaginal discharge, I have already told, it will be whitish, or it will be clear or transparent. It can be thick, but not very thick. Usually it is thin and mucoid type. Mucoid means its consistency will be like the saliva. We all have seen the saliva, how it looks like. So exactly like the saliva, you will see the physiological vaginal discharge. Most of the time it is odorless, and it is common in reproductive age group. So while taking the history, few points should be remember. They are must to ask, like color of discharge, smell of discharge. You will ask whether it's the foul smelling, whether the smell is kind of fishy smell. The presence of blood in the discharge, this is very important, because the vaginal discharge in reproductive age group are fine. They may be infective or non-infective causes we have already discussed. But if it is in the late age group, or the late of the middle age, like 35 plus. So vaginal discharge can be the symptom of cervical cancer as well. So presence of blood is important because it indicates the sign of malignancy or the pelvic inflammatory, chronic pelvic inflammatory disease. Then you will ask about relationship with the menstrual cycle. If the vaginal discharge typically occurs after the menstrual phase, then it can be physiological, because usually infective or pathological discharge are not related to the menstrual cycle. They are independent of the variation of the cycle. And then you will ask the associated symptoms of the vaginal discharge. So what are the associated symptoms of the vaginal discharge? Associated symptoms include itching, irregularity in the menstrual cycle. If the pelvic inflammatory disease is chronic, it can lead to irregularity in the menstrual cycle, as you and presence of blood, presence of itching, presence of dermatitis due to vaginal discharge. These all are associated symptoms, and the most common one is pelvic pain and the presence of fever. They all are associated with the infective discharge. Then, apart from the history related to the discharge, the important one is the past medical history. It will tell you if the patient is diabetic or she's on immunosuppressive. So this can be the risk factor for having vaginal discharge due to immunocompromised state. Sexual history is very important because in sexually transmitted infection, you will find the history of multiple partners, either in the female or the male partner. Then obstetric history is important because maybe the patient is giving you history of delivery or cesarean section 2 or 3 months back, and now she has come to you with the complaint of discharge. So it may be related to the pelvic inflammatory infection secondary to the postpartum status or any complication related to the delivery. And in gynecological history, you will ask about the symptoms of like menstrual history, relationship to the menstrual cycle. Then contraceptive history is important because exogenous estrogen leads to increased vaginal discharge. Menstrual history, drug history, like history of taking immunosuppressive drugs. Family history is important. And family history is important on account of asking comorbids like the diabetes, history of diabetes, and then social history, because sexually transmitted infections and the pelvic inflammatory disease are more common in low socioeconomic status. Okay, so if the discharge on examination, you any patient who complains or presented an OPD with complaint of vaginal discharge, you need to examine her. For examination, you will insert the Cusco speculum inside the vagina to see the vaginal discharge. If it is clear and white, then it is physiological. If it is mucopurulent, like thick kind of discharge, or you can say pussy, if the look of discharge is pussy kind of, so it can be due to gonorrhea or pelvic inflammatory disease or chlamydia. They are typical of gonorrhea and chlamydia if it is yellowish or pussy kind of discharge. If it is thick and curdy, like the thick old yogurt, if it is giving looks of thick and curdy type, then mostly it is candidiasis, vulvovaginal candidiasis. If it is frothy, frothy means if it is giving showing you bubbles kind of appearance, and it is yellowish to green, then it is typical of trichomoniasis. And if it is grayish white, like you see in the physiological kind of discharge, if it is white but it is slightly grayish white or opaque white, then you can think of bacterial vaginosis as well. Sometimes the look of discharge is so confusing that you cannot differentiate whether it is mucopurulent or whether it is grayish white. But if the appearance is typical of grayish white or the frothy yellow, then you can definitely diagnose on the examination of the vaginal discharge. Well, in candidiasis, it is easy to diagnose on inspection, and rest of the infection are mostly diagnosed on the culture test. So this is the position We insert the speculum inside the vagina in lithotomy position to see the vaginal discharge. So now we are going to discuss all the infections one by one. If you are suspecting gonorrhea in Neisseria gonorrhea in patient with complaint of vaginal discharge, then you will see the mucopurulent kind of discharge. And here in the picture, you can see this is the cervix, which is reddish in color, and you can see the thread-like structures coming out of the cervix, which is basically the thick kind of discharge or the pussy type of discharge. This is typical of gonorrhea and chlamydia. So if we are talking about gonorrhea, you can ask the patient about symptoms of dysuria, which is typical in chronic gonorrhea infection. Lower abdominal pain, if it has been ascended to the uterus and fallopian tubes, patient will complain of lower abdominal pain, and patient may give you history of postcoital or intramenstrual bleeding. If the infection is so severe, it can lead to bleeding as well. Organism involved is Neisseria gonorrhea. You must have read in your pathology and microbiology as well about this organism. This is gram-negative diplococci. It is very common in females, and it mostly affects endocervix area. So when we have to examine the patient, when we have to take the sample of the vaginal discharge for those patients in which we are suspecting gonococcal infection, you will take the swab from the endocervix region. But unfortunately, 50% of the female having Neisseria gonorrhea infection are asymptomatic. They don't have symptoms, or they presented with the symptoms when it is very late and it has become the chronic PID or pelvic inflammatory disease. Incubation period is 2 to 7 days, and it is most common in young females. Okay, complications of Neisseria gonorrhea is Bartholin abscess. I don't know you have been posted to gynae OPD till now or not. There are many patients come with complaint of Bartholin cyst at the vulvo-vaginal junction. So that is typical of gonorrhea infection. Or it can lead to pelvic inflammatory disease, because if infection ascends to the pelvic structure, it is known as pelvic inflammatory disease. And if the patient is having pelvic inflammatory disease due to gonorrhea, then patient may present with a history of fever, septic arthritis, or the small blisters in small joints. And definitely, this pelvic inflammatory disease will affect the uterus and fallopian tubes, so it may lead to infertility. And if it is in the pregnant patient is affecting from the Neisseria gonorrhea, then it can lead to ophthalmia nuneatorium in the neonate when it will pass through the birth canal. You can see the picture of the newborn. If the mother is having Neisseria gonorrhea and the baby has been passed through the birth canal during delivery, it can lead to this kind of infection. So if you are suspecting Neisseria gonorrhea, you will need to take endocervical swab for the culture. Or if you are suspecting in the case of abuse or harassment, and you cannot take the swab so high up in the vagina, then you can take the vulvo-vaginal swab. Okay, so this is the microscopic picture. On microscopy, you will see the cocci, diplococci. On the culture, you will see the Neisseria gonorrhea gray colonies. Actually, this is not included in your gynae syllabus, but you must be knowing, because it's all from the microbiology. And the NART test, which is commonly done for chlamydia infection, for NART test, we take vulvo-vaginal swab. And the treatment of gonorrhea infection is cefixime 400 mg. Injection ceftriaxone, which is given 250 mg, it is actually given instead. If we are given oral drug, then we will give the 5 days treatment, at least 5 days treatment. Okay, there's a question, why can't NART be done using an endocervical swab? Actually, NART test is typical for chlamydia infection, not for the gonorrhea infection, but the presentation of both the gonorrhea and chlamydia infection is almost same. So that's why if we are suspecting gonorrhea, we take the NART sample as well to rule out chlamydia infection. And sometimes both the infections can occur simultaneously. So it's needed to do the NART test if you are suspecting, if you have seen the symptoms of gonorrhea or chlamydia. Otherwise, typical for gonorrhea is endocervical swab, and we do the culture test, not the NART test for the gonorrhea infection. Okay, there's a difference. Culture test is different. Microscopy is different. Microscopy means you have taken the swab, you have spread it on the slide, and you are just seeing from the microscope what is apparent. In culture, you make the organism to grow on the culture. Then you diagnose whether it is there or not. So these tests are different. And NART is totally different from both of these entities. So if there is gonorrhea infection, you need to give cefixime, or the other choice is IM ceftriaxone injection. And partner tracing is required because it is a sexually transmitted infection. So you need to test the partner as well and avoid sexual relationship until both partners are completely treated and their repeat test is negative for the infection. Then you can allow the sexual relationship. Next is chlamydia, which is also very common in the young age group. This is also sexually transmitted infection. Appearance is purulent discharge or mucopurulent discharge, like you see in the gonorrhea infection. And if chlamydia is left untreated, it can lead to palpi-inflammatory disease, and it can lead to occlusion of fallopian tubes as well, which is the very common cause of infertility. So chlamydia should be treated on time. It can also involve the urinary tract and lead to dysuria, lower abdominal pain, postcoital intermenstrual bleeding, and dyspareunia. There are different strains of chlamydia from D to K. These are the names of different strains. They are basically negative obligatory intracellular bacteria. And nearly 70% of females are asymptomatic when they are having chlamydia infection. They are basically diagnosed when the female presents with the infertility and we see the tubal blockage. Then we come to know, oh, that was basically due to chlamydia infection. Complications is pelvic inflammatory disease, as it affects the fallopian tube. So ectopic pregnancy is common with the chlamydia infection. It can lead to, if infection has been ascended through the fallopian tubes to the peritoneal cavity, it can lead to perihepatitis. And it can lead to reactive arthritis as well. If the patient has acquired this infection during pregnancy, then it can lead to preterm birth, postpartum infections, and ophthalmian uniturium. Although it is less common in chlamydia infection, eye infections of the neonates is less common in the chlamydia infection as compared to gonorrhea. Okay, for chlamydia, then again, you will take the endocervical and vulvovaginal swab because you have to differentiate the gonorrhea and chlamydia. Investigation. Microscopy does not give confirmatory result if it is the chlamydia. But it can show you a polymorphonuclear leukocyte, more than 30 high power field, and there will be no diplococci to rule out the gonorrhea. So that's how you can differentiate on the microscopy, but it's not confirmed. Nuclear amplification test is the diagnostic for chlamydia. For infection of chlamydia and for treatment of chlamydia infection, the drug of choice is doxycycline, 100 mg BD for 7 days. Doxycycline in market comes with the name of vibramycin. Maybe you have heard this name. Vibramycin is a very common drug. It is basically doxycycline. Or if the doxycycline is contraindicated, like in pregnancy, it is contraindicated. In breastfeeding, we avoid doxycycline. So the other choice is azithromycin, 1 gram instead, or you can give for 3 days as well. And then it is a sexually transmitted infection. So you need to avoid sexual relationship. You need to do partner testing as well to rule out the infection. Then next is trichomoniasis. Trichomoniasis infection, it is profuse frothy, yellowish, grayish discharge. Sometimes it looks like the discharge of candidiasis as well. So, and it can lead to, it can involve the urinary tract as well. So, patient may give you symptoms of urinary tract infection like dysuria, abdominal discomfort. Trichomoniasis also leads to vulval itching. So, itching is the characteristic feature of trichomoniasis and the fungal infections, which we will be discussing later. It can cause dyspareunia as well, and it's, very rarely, almost 1 or 2% of cases can show you strawberry cervix. Strawberry cervix means when you will be seeing the cervix through the speculum in lithotomy position, you may see the red hemorrhagic spots over the cervix, which gives like appearance of strawberry. So that is called strawberry cervix, and it is typical of trichomoniasis. Trichomoniasis is caused by the organism which is flagellated. So on microscopy, you can see the flagellated protozoa, which will give you a clue that it's the trichomoniasis infection. It is one of the most common sexually transmitted infection. And unfortunately, it is asymptomatic in 10 to 50% of females. Complications in pregnancy, trichomoniasis vaginalis is the very common cause of preterm birth and low birth weight babies. And although the chlamydia and gonorrhea also causes may cause preterm birth, but it is more common in trichomoniasis. Secretions from the posterior fornix is collected into the swab. For trichomoniasis, you will take the high vaginal swab or the sample from the posterior fornix. The fornix is the area where the vagina and cervix meets. So this is the high vaginal swab which will be taken in cases of trichomoniasis infection, which can be sent for culture and microscopy. On microscopy, you will see the wet smear. You will see the motile flagella along with the organism. So it will give you a hint that it is trichomoniasis. And on culture, you will see the organism growing in the TYM medium. And this is the diagnostic for trichomoniasis. Treatment for trichomoniasis is metronidazole. Metronidazole comes with the name of Flagyl, which is a very common drug. But for PID, we give in the BD dose for 7 days, 7 to 14 days. And as it is sexually transmitted infection, so you will follow the same protocol, avoid sexual relationship until the complete treatment. You need to test the partner as well. Then vulvovaginal candidiasis. This is not the sexually transmitted infection, and it's a kind of fungal infection. There are many kind of candidiasis or the candida species. The most common is Candida albicans. In non-albican, there are species Candida glabrata, Candida tropicalis, and yeast. But in 90% of cases, you will see the Candida albicans will be the responsible for the fungal infection. But in some patients, you may see Candida glabrata or tropicalis. So in picture, you can see this is the typical look of Candida albicans infection. It looks like it's look like curd, whitish curdy pieces you will see inside the vagina or over the cervix, and it is typically caused by Candida albicans. It is a fungal infection, so it is more common in patients who are immunocompromised, like in diabetic patient. If the diabetes is uncontrolled, it may lead to recurrent Candida infection. If patient is on immunosuppressive or taking antibiotics for a long time, it may lead to candidial infection. So thick, white, non-offensive vaginal discharge is the characteristic of candidial infection. Vulval itching, vulval soreness due to persistent itching, and due to itching and dermatitis, it can lead to superficial dyspareunia due to vulval irritation. And you can see a fissuring of the skin over the vulva due to continuous itching and vulval edema as well. So predisposing factors are long-term steroid, diabetes, pregnancy, because pregnancy itself is an immunocompromised state, and prolonged antibiotic use. and how you will diagnose. You will take the vaginal swab from the lateral fornix. You can also take from the posterior fornix. It's same whether you take from the lateral fornix or the posterior fornix. Basically, you need to take high vaginal swab when you are suspecting candida infection. Microscopy of vaginal smear, you can, on microscope, you will see the hyphae and spores, which is typical of fungal infection. And on culture, you will see the growth of and the budding of the organism. Treatment will definitely be antifungal, but you need to remove the predisposing factor. If the predisposing factor is prolonged use of antibiotics, you need to discontinue it. If the factor is the uncontrolled diabetes, you need to control the diabetes. Otherwise, patient will have recurrent infection. For a treatment, if the first line treatment is topical, but if the after if the patient is a virgin or unmarried or she is not responding to the topical treatment, you may go for oral treatment. In oral treatment, you have a choice: fluconazole, 150 milligram instead, or the itraconazole can be used. You don't need to remember the dosage at your level, but you must be knowing the treatment required, like fluconazole or itraconazole. For topical use, we have clotrimazole, miconazole, and statin. These all drugs are used as a topical in the form of cream or the vaginal pessaries, which are kept inside the vagina. But in case of candidiasis, as it is not the sexually transmitted infection, so you don't need to do the treatment of partner. Then bacterial vaginosis. It is also an infection of immunocompromised people. It is not transmitted sexually, but it can be the frequent cause of vaginal discharge, especially if the female is not sexually active and it has been presented to you with infective kind of vaginal discharge. Then cause can be bacterial vaginosis, and it is very common. There are different kind of organism. Actually, basically, bacterial vaginosis is due to disruption in the normal flora of the vagina. We all know normal flora of the vagina is consist of Gardnerella, Vaginalis, Prevotella species, Mycoplasma hominis, Mobilincus species. They all are part of normal flora of the vagina. But if there is overgrowth of any of these organism, it may lead to alter the pH of the vagina, which is usually acidic. The pH of vagina is 4.2 to 4.3, but if the pH has been disturbed due to overgrowth of the any of the mentioned organism, then it can lead to bacterial vaginosis. On examination, you will see the grayish white homogeneous vaginal discharge. Offensive fishy odor is the characteristic of the bacterial vaginosis, but you will not see any kind of inflammation or ulceration or fissure type of thing in bacterial vaginosis. Predisposing factors are vaginal douching. Vaginal douching is now obsolete. It was common in the previous ages, where female used to do cleaning or washing of the vagina, so which disturbed the normal flora of the vagina and lead to the bacterial vaginosis. Oral sex, smoking, antibiotic use, or recent change in sex partner may lead to alteration in the normal flora of the vagina, and IUCD as well. On investigation, on microscopic, you will see the clue cells. Clue cells is a typical kind of cell in which normal epithelial cell is surrounded by the excessive bacteria, like most common is Gardnerella vaginalis, which is the organism. If the normal epithelium cell is surrounded by multiples of organisms which are stick over its surface, then it will give the appearance of clue cells. As you can see in the picture, normal epithelial cell, and when it is surrounded by sticking of the bacteria, it will give the appearance of clue cell, and clue cell is typical of bacterial vaginosis. You will not see clue cells in any of the other infection. So in exam, you may be asked such type of questions, that clue cell is diagnostic of which infection. So you will have to answer, this is bacterial vaginosis. And there is a diagnostic criteria for the diagnosis of bacterial vaginosis, which is known as AMSIL criteria. I think name is not written over here. It was invented by the scientists, which and it is named as after the name of scientist MCL criteria. MCL criteria means there are certain 4 to 5 characteristics. If out of 5, 3 characters are present, then it means this patient is having bacterial vaginosis. The first one is presence of clue cell and microscopic examination, yellowish gray discharge on the vaginal examination or on the inspection, pH of vagina, which is tested with the litmus paper, if it is more than 4.5, or if the sample of the discharge which you have been taken on the glass slide, if on the spray of 10% potassium hydroxide, if it gives fishy odor, it means it may be bacterial vaginosis. So out of these four, if the patient is having three of the characteristic, it is typical of the bacterial vaginosis, or it is diagnostic of the bacterial vaginosis. Treatment for bacterial vaginosis is metronidazole, or which comes with the name of Flagyl in the market. Then we are coming to the non-infective causes of vaginal discharge. Among non-infective causes, it can be basically it is due to the irritation of the any kind of foreign structure. Foreign structure can be any of the foreign body, or cervical polyp, or thread of intrauterine contraceptive device. It can lead to irritation and vaginal discharge. So this was the end of lecture. As you, I have told you all the characteristics of the vaginal discharge, and how you can diagnose on the basis of the inspection and color of the vaginal discharge. And so your question of history taking will be directed towards the diagnosis. If patient is saying she is having complaint of vaginal discharge, you will ask from the amount of discharge, the color of discharge, associated symptoms along with the discharge. Then comes the menstrual history, drug history, comorbids, sexual history. Then if there's a positive sexual history, then you will ask about the partner as well. So then comes the inspection on and examination. On examination and inspection of the vaginal secretion, you will see the characteristic colors of the vaginal secretion. On the basis of those colors of the discharge and the amount of discharge and the characteristic of discharge, you can have a differential diagnosis that what kind of infection she is having. And then of course microscopy and culture test comes, which will give you the 100% diagnosis. So any question you can ask in the chat box. Okay, there's a question. In our clinical setting, how do we ask about sexual history? Actually, at your level, definitely it must be difficult to ask, but you need to ask, and we do ask. Usually, we ask about sexual history in a way that क्या आपके और आपके शोहर के जिनसी ताल्लुकात सिर्फ आपस में ही हैं, क्या इसके अलावा तो नहीं है? दैट्स हाउ वी आस्क कि आपके जिनसी ताल्लुकात जो है आपके शोहर से ही हैं. सो इफ शी से यस, तो इट्स मीन यस. एंड मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम, ऑलमोस्ट आई थिंक ऑलवेज पेशेंट नेवर से डेट आई हैव मल्टीपल पार्टनर. दैट्स द डिलेमा ऑफ आर सोसाइटी. बट यू नीड टू आस्क ऑन योर अकाउंट, सो यू कैन से डेट पेशेंट डिनाइज मल्टीपल पार्टनर. एंड इफ हर हस्बेंड और हर पार्टनर इज हैविंग मल्टीपल कॉन्टेक्ट, शी विल डेफिनेटली टेल यू. सो यू नीड टू आस्क कि आपके या आपके शोहर के आपस में एक दूसरे के अलावा किसी और से तो जिनसे ताल्लुकात नहीं है. लेट्स हाउ वी आस्क. एनीथिंग एल्स? ओके, इफ देयर इज नो क्वेश्चन देन वी विल एंड द लेक्चर. सो
जी
प्लीज लेट
मैडम,
मी नो.
मैडम एंड करें
टाइम तो अभी नहीं हुआ है, 5 मिनट रुक जाते हैं. अगर कोई क्वेश्चन आते हैं तो ठीक है, फिर बंद कर
ना, वो
दीजिएगा.
चैटिंग में आएगा, चैट चैट में ना क्वेश्चन करेंगे.
जी, मैं देख रही हूँ चैट में. ओके, सो हेयर आई एम शेयरिंग माई मेल आईडी. इफ यू वॉन्ट टू आस्क एनी क्वेश्चन, यू कैन सेंड मी. So for now, I am signing off the lecture. So this is my mail ID. If there's any question, you can ask. So I think there's no question for now. Waisab, aap lecture band kar sakte hain.